Good morning. So I'm good to see so many out on a dreary, rainy morning. I don't have too many announcements this morning. The kitchen will be finished tomorrow. Both companies have said they will call the inspectors to come in before the end of the year. And I learned something new that has to be done before the end of the year, or else we have to pay for new permits. And I said, oh, no. So they're going to take care of that for us. In with your services and the newsletters, you found a little piece of paper. In order to best prepare for Christmas Eve and Christmas Day worship, for Holy Communion and printing of services, I ask you to fill this out and leave it in the connection card basket on your way out of church. And again, on your way out, please make sure you social distance, make sure there's space between you and the people in front of you leaving the sanctuary on your way out. Otherwise, I think everything else is pretty much in the newsletter for today. And we look forward to worshiping together, and Pastor Huser is back with us today. And so thank you, Pastor Huser, for coming down and leading us in worship this morning.
Good morning. It's always a pleasure to be coming here. I figured out what was wrong the last couple of times I was here. Things didn't feel right. And that's all those masks. I figured that. But what I lost was, I don't see your smiles. So I guess we'll just smile at this okay here. To begin with our opening gift, please rise if you are able.
Thank you. Old Testament reading is from Jeremiah, the 29th chapter. For thus says the Lord, when 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and gather you from all the nations and all the places where I have driven you, declares the Lord. And I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our New Testament reading is from Philippians, the 4th chapter. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Notice that the first part of the gospel here, it says, see all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations, and from David to the deportation of Babylon, 14 generations, and from the deportation of Babylon to the Christ, 14 generations. You see a pattern there? God does things in his own way and plans his own things. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the first chapter. Praise to you, Lord Christ. So the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations. And from David to the deportation of Babylon, 14 generations. And from the deportation to Babylon to the Christ, 14 generations. Now the birth of Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man, and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. And this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you. Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
Question for you. When was the last time that your carefully laid plans fell apart? Didn't take long to figure that one out, did it? I had some plans for this summer. Plans that I knew what was going to happen this last year. You know, when my plans fell apart, I didn't get a visit from an angel. Where was God's plan? He didn't tell me. But he had a plan. And he has a plan. The basis of the whole point of it is really not whether we know what God's plan is, but whether we're willing to trust God that he has a plan, and that that plan is for our good and for his glory. We talk about a people that had a plan. Today I'd like to share a little bit about Joseph. We don't hear much about Joseph. He's this very, very important figure. He's the father of the Son of God on this earth. He raises Jesus. But you know what? We have no direct quotes of anything he said. He didn't write any books in the Bible. And yet here's this extremely important person in the life of Jesus, that's just there. So I'd like to take a little bit of a look at him today, kind of see where his plans and God's plans might have divvied a little bit, and what his reactions to God's plans were. So we start off very simply. He's a young man, and by whatever means, whether it's arranged between parents, or whether he noticed Mary in the village mall, or the family friends, whatever, he becomes betrothed to Mary. Now, betrothed is not like our engagements in a lot of ways. It's much more, and basically, it's so involved and so legally set up that the only thing really happens at the wedding is this celebration where they come together as the household. He goes and gets her and brings her in his house. And then, of course, the consummation of the marriage. But in the eyes of the people, and the family, and Mary and Joseph, they were married. Well, Joseph's plans probably went something like this, and I'm going to say this a long time, and I don't know what Joseph's plans were because they were never written down. But what they probably were is Joseph expected to have a normal life. He was going to marry this girl he loves. They were going to have children together. He was going to raise the children, teach it to sons, his trade, to be carpenters, to earn a living. Someday as they grew older, perhaps Mary and Joseph could back off a little bit and the children would take over and the sons would take over the business and life would be pretty nice in this small town of Nazareth. But Mary does this thing. She takes off on a girl's weekend. Only it's a girl's 3 months. And she goes and she visits Elizabeth. Now, Elizabeth is her cousin. And as you know, she's the mother of John the Baptist. And when Mary goes, Elizabeth's about 6 months pregnant. And Mary goes and she stays with her for like 3 months. And she comes back to Nazareth just before John the Baptist is born. And the cat's out of the bag. Because Mary is going to have a baby. Mary, in Joseph's plans, are now messed up because Mary was unfaithful to him. He doesn't have a whole lot of choices. He can divorce her quietly. He can divorce her publicly and bring shame to her that she deserves in his mind. And that shame could lead to her death. But Joseph's a good man. And I expect he cared for Mary. So he decides, after much consideration and probably a whole lot of angst, that he's going to do the right thing, take the high road, and divorce her quietly. And when he divorces her quietly, it won't be quite so bad for her. But before he can do that, he goes to sleep, and he gets visited by an angel of the Lord. And the angel of the Lord says, "Joseph, you got this wrong. Mary didn't do anything to disgrace you. Mary has been chosen to bear the Son of God, the Messiah that was long promised. And you're going to be the father. You're going to be the earthly father." And so, when he wakes, Joseph goes, Mary wasn't making up all that hogwash. It's the truth. God did come to her. Can you imagine what the astonishment must have been like in his head? That it's true? A virgin will conceive and have a baby? Wow. Well, as Joseph decides to stay married to, or become finally married to, Mary, he does something besides just take the high road. He also takes on her shame. Because now what the town thinks, and probably what the family thinks, is they kind of rushed the wedding. Shame on them. But Joseph and Mary know better. So Joseph's plans messed up. But you know what? I suspect that he came up with a new plan. He came up with a new plan, you know, for a quiet life in Nazareth. Eventually, the people would forget all about the, you know, the rushing the marriage. The kids would grow up. He'd have this cradle that he handmade for the baby, and it'd be very special. His family would be around to help with the birth, and it would be really cool. But God's plan's a little different. God's plan says to a man called Caesar Augustus that Caesar decides he wants more money. And the way to get more money is to tax his people. And the way to know how many people he needs to tax is to make everybody go to their hometown of their ancestors. Not where they're living now, but where their ancestors came from. So Joseph's plans are once again messed up. Because now with God's plan, he has to travel on a 100-mile trip with a wife who is 9 months pregnant. And he doesn't get to do it in some nice, squishy car. We don't even know if they had a donkey. We think they did. We hope they did. But 100 miles is a long way. And it's all uphill. And so he heads back. They go to Jerusalem. I suspect that Joseph's plans were to find him a hotel, maybe a midwife, and, you know, just kind of have this reasonable, comfortable birth of the baby, and everything will be cool. Problem is that God's plan is a little different. Because when they get there, there are hundreds of people in this tiny little town. And they took all the Motel 6s, all the Marriotts, all the Holiday Inns, and there isn't a hotel to be found. And so they end up in a place where they keep the animals, a stable. In that stable, Mary has her baby. And she wraps him in these swaddling cloths, puts him in a manger, a place for animals to feed from. Not the cradle that Joseph had made with his hands that was special for this new baby. Nope, it was different. God's plan was different. Because God's son was born not in a palace, not in some super hospital, not with the best doctors in town, but just in a special, quiet home. Certainly one that probably no husband would wish for their wives or their children. But God's plan was different. Now Joseph, his plans probably would be a little different also. When he thought that they were going to have the baby in Nazareth, what would he think? The first visitors are going to be who? His family and his friends. That the town would be happy for them. But the reality of it is that God's plan was not to have a big deal of telling the world. God's plan was to reveal his birth to these lowly shepherds, the bottom of the rung, so to speak. And they come and they visit Mary with this news that is shared with them by these angels. In the town, what do they know? It's sort of like this story, kind of imagination here. It's happened quite a few years ago, and there was a town called Hodgensville, Kentucky. And there was a man there, a traveler, who went out of the city and been gone a while. And when he comes back to the city, he meets his neighbor. And his neighbor says, "What's going on out in the world?" And so the traveler tells him about the wars in Europe and all the news that's going on out there, the latest fashions, whatever it may be. But finally the man says, "Well, while I was gone, did anything special happen around here?" The neighbor goes, "Not much. Mrs. Lincoln had a baby, and I think his name was Abraham." I'm not getting those reactions. Abraham Lincoln, nobody knew who he was in the town when he was born, but he grows up to be the president. You got it now, okay. It's kind of the same thing. The Son of God, Jesus, is born in Bethlehem. Nobody really knows. But God knew. And God knows what's to come. You see, the birth of Jesus kind of went unnoticed to the world. There were no big announcements in the newspaper. NPR didn't carry a story. The science reviews didn't say it was impossible. It was kind of a very low-key thing. The angels from heaven announced to the shepherds. And the shepherds share that story. The world events? Nah, not so much. So we've got Joseph now. The baby's been born. And he says, what's next? Well, one thing that's next is 40 days after the birth of a child, the mother needs to go and that child to the temple. And the temple, and they need to make an offering for the firstborn, and the child gets dedicated. And so they travel the 8 miles or so to Jerusalem. And Joseph's just doing what should be done. Kind of a neat day, like our baptism day is a special day. And, you know, perhaps on the way home he's planning on stopping at Perkins for breakfast. But nothing really special. God's plan. He shows up and the priests are too busy. They don't have time to take care of this nondescript child from a who knows where. They got their own business to do. But out of the nowhere comes this man. This man, Simon. And he comes to him and he says, and it's an astonishing thing. The Lord promised me that before I died, I would see his Messiah. And so he gives us those wonderful words. Words that we say so often that just went out of my mind. Somebody help me. Lord, thou doughtest thou thy servant depart in peace, for my eyes have seen thy salvation. A light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of his people Israel. I don't expect that Joseph and Mary were looking for that. And then comes this very old woman that had been in the temple for years and years and years, decades, devoted to the Lord, to prayer. She comes up and says, "This is the Christ. This is who has been promised for thousands of years, our Savior, our Redeemer." But the priests, they're too busy. And the priests who know all of this history and all of God's word that they have written down miss the whole thing. But God's promises made to those two people aren't forgotten. God's plans are different. So now what's Joseph expecting? Well, they probably went back to Nazareth, and he probably assumes that at some point they'll go back to Nazareth, but right now things are going okay in Bethlehem, and so he's probably working with all those people there. I'm sure they broke some furniture or whatever, and he was needed. So he works there for a while, and probably planning on heading back home to a normal life eventually. But God's plan was a little different. Because all of a sudden, these three kings of Orient are, or the three wise men, or we think they're three, show up. And they want to know where the king of the Jews is. And they want to worship him, and they bring him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And they fall down and they worship this baby. Joseph and Mary got to be doing, you know, the look. But yet, they still have seen so many things. And God brings this, these wise men, far, far away. He puts a very special star in the sky that although scientists think they might have a clue about it, they're sure not quite sure how it all happened. But God had a plan that he was going to bring these people from the east, from this faraway place, so that they would see God's Son. Wow, things are exciting in Nazareth. So after that wise men leave, you've got to figure, well, they were probably talking about what was going on. Like, wow, look at this. What is this? What does it mean? How did God do that? And then they go to sleep. And Joseph gets another visit from an angel. And the angel says, get out of town. Because Herod wants to kill your son. And so they head out of town in the middle of the night. And they go to Egypt. Probably not in Joseph's plan. But God's plan said, I will call my son out of Egypt. He prophesied that. God's plan was for them to go to Egypt. How long they stayed there, we're not sure. Eventually, they decided to come home. And they're heading back towards home, wherever that was going to be, maybe Bethlehem. But they heard that Herod's dead, but his son Antipas was now the patriarch. And so instead they go to Nazareth, back to their hometown. Hopefully things are going to be normal for now, right? Well, it appears they are. We don't know much about what happened from then on. But in Nazareth, Jesus grew up. He grew up learning the scriptures. We know he eventually learned at least three languages, Aramaic and Hebrew, and probably Greek. He studied. He learned what little boys do. His father taught him how to hold a saw or a chisel, how to make his first table or chair. And he taught him the things. He taught him how to treat his wife. He taught him how to treat a woman. How to treat fairly other people. Jesus didn't all of a sudden, you know, at a certain age where things happen. So like, you know, a two-year-old should know this much, and all of a sudden Jesus knew it because he was God's son. Remember, he'd given up meanness in terms of his divine nature. He learned just like you and I have. And he was taught by his father and his mother and his family around him. Because Joseph and Mary were faithful. We don't know what happened. But regularly, each year, Joseph, as a faithful Jew, as he was supposed to. And so, when Jesus is 12 years old, Joseph's plans are normal. We're going to go to the to the temple, and we're going to travel with our friends in a group, it's safer, head out from Nazareth. And they travel that 100 miles or so, and they end up in the temple, and they do the things they're supposed to do, and they've stayed there for a while, we don't know how long they stayed, but they decide to head home. And so they all pack up together, and the caravan, the group gets together, and they head for home. And, you know, Mary and Joseph, they take the kids and, you know, are out with their friends, Jesus is up there instead of, you know, with his parents. Come on, the guy's going to be a teenager. You know, teenagers don't hang around with their parents. But they go to camp for the night, the first night, and there's no Jesus. And so Joseph's plans of a nice journey home aren't going to happen. And so they head back to Jerusalem. And if they're a day travel away, it's a day travel back. The third day, they start looking. They're looking for Jesus. Where is he? Is he in the pool hall? Is he at a bar? Is he out with some friends he made there? No. They find Jesus, a 12-year-old, sitting in the temple, astounding them with his knowledge of God and the scriptures and what God's plans really were. Well, at this time, I think Joseph's plan was sort of like, I'm going to let Mom handle this one. Because, you know, Mary goes up to Jesus and says, what did you do? Where were you? Why were you worrying your father and I? And I don't think she or Joseph expected that answer. But Jesus knew who he was to be and his role. And he looked at Mary and he said, don't you know that I'm to be about my father's business? And he didn't mean a carpenter like Joseph. He meant the business that his father in heaven had sent him here to earth to do. Mary and Joseph must have had a wow moment again. But they had been entrusted with the Son of God that they could raise. We don't know much more about the family life of Jesus after age 12, except that he went home and he grew in wisdom and knowledge. We don't hear about Joseph anymore. But here's some things we know about Joseph. We know that Joseph regularly exchanged his plans for God's plans. We know that Joseph, and the evidence shows that even in the weirdest times, in the most unusual circumstances, he followed God's plans. And although he never knew any public glory, there's not one word, not one quote in the Bible that's attributed to Joseph. There's no book of the Bible that's been written about him. This man is kind of a background man. And yet, as he quietly lived the life in the background, he was faithful to God's plans to raise God's son. And he did that as a quiet, faithful servant. Now, I'm not making this guy sinless. I'm not saying he didn't yell at once at times. I'm not saying he didn't get frustrated when God changed the plans. But all the evidence points to the fact that he trusted God, that God had a plan for him. I wonder, are you someone that God called to be in a public position? Someone who the public would see and see your faith and your promises to God and your faithfulness and your life carried out? Perhaps like Mary? Or were you called by God to be someone like Joseph? Quietly, with no public fanfare, nobody knowing your name as a great person, but knowing that you are faithful to what God has called you to and to following his will in your lives. You see, both of them are called to faithfulness. Whether you're in a public view like Mary was, or whether you're in a quiet, behind the scenes like Joseph, both are called to be faithful to God's will. Both are called to be special. One's not better than the other. They're equal as they follow the calling and the planning that God has for them. Which are you? really doesn't matter. What really matters is, are you looking in your lives on a daily basis to find out what God's plan for your life is? Today, tomorrow. Are we to make plans? Of course we're to make plans. We're given reason and senses and a brain. Of course we're to make plans. But God calls us to make those plans with the knowledge that if He changes something, that our willingness is that we are willing to change. So I'm going to ask you this question again. Did you have plans for 2020? I did. Mine didn't go the way I thought they would. Haven't been allowed to visit my son. Haven't had my wife in church. Haven't been regularly able to attend church. I can't go to restaurants. I can't be with my friends. I can't see your smiley faces. And I hate wearing a mask. 2020 hasn't gone to the way I thought it should go. And you know what? I've got to be honest with you. I'm not sure I totally understand what God's plan is. He hasn't told me all the details yet. I got some thoughts. I'll give you a quick one. There's no gospel behind this, and this is not pastor speaking. This is just Mark speaking. So I have this little scenario in my mind where God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, they're all sitting around having coffee one morning. And the Father says, you know what? I have had it with my people. I have given them everything. I have given them computers, newspapers, radio, television, social media. And they sit in their churches on their butts, and they wait for people to come to hear the story of my salvation. And I've had enough. You know what? I'm going to make it so they can't do that anymore. So they got to wise up. They got to find other means and ways to share the gospel. I don't know if that's true or not. I think it's true we need to do that. But I don't know if that's God's plan. I think the real point of the whole thing is, are you willing to give up the plans you have for 2020? All the rocks and walls that you've walked into, all the things you don't understand, are you willing to let God's plan run in the way it should go? Even if you don't understand it. The epistle lesson today has got a little bit to say with that. The book of Philippians, chapter 4. Rejoice in the Lord always, even in December 2020, in the midst of a pandemic. Again, I say to you, rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone, that you're willing to follow God's plan. For the Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything in prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. That's God's promise. That's God's plan for your life. God said, I know the plans I have for you. Plans to, well, for your welfare, not for evil. To give you a future and a hope. The question that we have, and that I have for you, is, are you willing, in this time of kind of a mess, let God be God, and let the world know that you're following Him. That you trust Him, and that you trust Him for that peace that surpasses all understanding. I want to share with you a message that was sent to me by a good friend of mine, Sherry. She was also the organist at my church, and she passed this on. I want to share it with you. I know some of you have seen the post about the Christmas star appearing this year on December 21st. I couldn't help but really take a deeper look at how amazing this occurrence would be happening in the year 2020. In the year when Jesus was born, there was violence, chaos, political and social unrest, and it was dark. The Magi found him by way of the star, which was the meeting of three stars, Jupiter, Saturn, and Mars, they think. And they followed the star until it rested on where he was. And they began to worship him. In the time where it, was dark, light was brought into our world. Jesus stepped into the chaos and brought peace. Now fast forward to the year 2020. It's a time of violence, chaos, political and social unrest. It is dark. December 21st will be the shortest day, and night is the longest. It's literally the darkest day, and is the beginning of what most of us would say is the cold winter season. But on the darkest day this year, Jupiter and Saturn meet, giving us the Christmas star. How fitting that in the moment of time during the Christmas season that we get to see this beautiful reminder that even in the darkest times, light will and has stepped into the chaos. He is there. In our darkest time, he is there. He brings light and makes all things new. So, as you look out on December 21st for the Christmas star, will you be reminded of his power and his light that he brings for all mankind? For he is perfect at stepping into chaos and bringing it into peace. May God bless you. May God fill your light with the life and the light and the joy that is the celebration of the birth of God's Son to be our Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
especially if you remember and ask for blessings on the death of a loved one. For Lori, for Larry, Sandy, and Austin Cannon, and on the death of Larry's mom, Parrish. And I can have that. We'll come back to the prayer. It says in the bulletin that, you know, they're not going to be kept candy like normal, so I just move right on. I'll learn eventually.
Let's pray to the Lord.
Lord,
and finally, for these and all of our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, we implore you to hear our prayers and to lighten the darkness in our hearts by your gracious visitation. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Blessed Lord, you have caused all Holy Scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, and learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and even hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We pray. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, as your dear Son, that you have had this time of our heart and nature. And I pray that you keep me this day of our hustle from sin and every evil, that all my doings and my dedication, for it is your hands I command myself, my body and my soul, and all things. Let your holy angels be with you, that the people fall together on our
thank you. and his children, okay? Ends of ends.
Are technology troubles slowing you down? Get unlimited access to the highest rated tech specialists with our best-selling IT support bundle, starting at just $14.95 per user per month. Our support bundle includes antivirus, monthly reports, and much more. Visit www.weldonpc.com/remote for more details. You can also enroll online or by phone by calling 216-475-6000.